Good morning. I want to thank the invitation made by my dear friend Dr. Ramiro for being here today. My talk won't bring nothing new or spectacular. It will be more kind of a summary of many things that were already said. When you turn 40, after the party and the cake, you will soon be aware that it will be downhill from here. And together with many other things, presbyopia will arrive. You can just accept it or go, you can declare war to glasses and start the journey of surgery. There is increasing interest in surgery options. We have mainly the intraocular approach, replacing the lens, or the extraocular approach, modifying the cornea or sclera. We can divide surgical approaches in the approach of enhancing depth of focus or an attempt to restore accommodation. You have many possible combinations, and at present there is no universally accepted best method for correcting refractive errors, and the final decision should be based on the lifestyle and vision needs of patient. So, the static methods for its correction seek to increase the depth of focus, which include monovision, corneal inlays, presbylasic, and the almost dead corneal shrinking techniques, and the multifocal IOLs. The dynamic methods such as scleral implants and accommodative IOLs to attempt to restore accommodation are not being used, at least not much. And yesterday, we talked about the ciliary muscle electrostimulation to restore accommodation. It's kind of, I think it can be included here in the dynamic methods, and probably we will have some future at least in people until the 50s. So the monovision is an attempt to provide acceptable distance and near vision that eliminates the need for spectacle wear by optimizing one eye for near vision, typical the non-dominant eye, and optimizing the other eye, typical the dominant eye for distant vision. Everybody knows this, but it's still very used today. With monovision, we have good visual outcomes, but there's a loss of stereopsis, which is related to the degree of anisometropia. And it's contraindicated in patients that need good stereopsis to perform their daily activities. We can use monovision through contact lenses, where also we have many possibilities of doing this. We have modified monovision, partial monovision, extended or enhanced monovision, many multiple ways of combining multifocal contact lenses. And then we have corneal inlays that are using monovision to get the enhanced depth of focus, at least the camera, the most used corneal inlay, and LASIK that we can use producing either monovision or multifocality, presbylasic. Concerning corneal inlays, I won't take long talking about this again, but I'll say that it can be combined with other refractive procedures. It has this advantage. It has quite fewer risks. The small aperture inlay camera is the most studied. It has been used safely and effectively with LASIK simultaneously or in a two-steps approach. There are also literature about their use with faking IOLs, but with short follow-ups. We have studies in pseudophakia, We have also the possibility of maintaining an inline when performing cataract surgery, removing it, placing one inlay after cellophagic monofocal surgery. So, inlays still have limitations. Laser after refractive lens exchange. There are also very few studies about this because almost all studies are doing in phakic patients. But Presbylasic has been used with success in cellophagic patients. But we know we should wait about 12 weeks to perform it. And there are still the concern of using laser with multifocal IOLs. Especially when we have aberrations, corneal aberrations, and be very careful in cases where there have been previous ocular surgery that could have induced high order aberrations. So laser after refractive lens exchange could be using monovision, LASIK, PRK, SMILE, or Presbylasic. There are several techniques, I won't take long talking about them. Central Presbylasic is the most used, and recently laser point vision, which is a combination of micro monovision and depth of field increase is gaining adepts. We have several technologies available of central presbylasic. The mechanism is the same. And more recently, laser blended vision with also good results. There's a problem. They almost all use micro monovision, which again can be inconvenient because of loss of stereopsis. So, according to a recent review of 2017 by Alio, micro monovision again, he says, may be inconvenient. So, patient selection remains the secret. Yesterday we talked about isovision. It could be a possibility in the future as long as the results will confirm it. Refractive lens exchange after LASIK, we have to be careful, but it's safe, effective, stable, many studies confirming it, predictable, but multifocal IOLs should be aspheric. So most of the procedures for correction of presbyopia in the cornea have the risk of losing lines of distance vision, which brings us to the crystalline lens and the multiple possibilities of multifocal IOLs, which have proved better than monofocal for near visual acuity and aided. And nowadays there are so many different approaches to multifocal IOLs it's really important that the choice of the lens would be customized to the patient. Multifocal IOLs is now an umbrella term, which has several designs, different lenses. It's not very useful to be categorizing the lens. Missing light has been done, is still being done. It has the advantage of giving kind of a blended vision. But there are very few publications dedicated to this topic. Again, it uses several times monovision or mini monovision. And it has the usual risks of that. Don't forget that placing a multifocal IOL behind the multifocal cornea runs the risk of an additional loss of contrast and reduction of quality of vision. So, multifocal IOLs have revealed to be safe and effective, but be careful with younger patients because they are more demanding. They have, in the literature, lower levels of satisfaction because of higher expectations. And then I will talk just a little bit about piggyback IOLs in the sulcus. It has an advantage because nowadays the supplementary IOLs are quite safe because they were specifically designed for sulcus placement, and the complications that used to be are now less frequent. And the Krylex can be performed as a primary duet procedure. We can put a monofocal IOL target on emmetropia in the back, and then use a multifocal IOL to give the patient the opportunity to feel how it is to have a multifocal vision. And then if you either don't tolerate that, remove the lens. This is the only effective reversible surgery for patients. We have many options: toric, monofocal, multifocal toric. We also talked yesterday about the IPCL, the fakey multifocal IOL that could have some relevance in the future if it's revealed safe. And in the future, we'll still be combining many different possible approaches. We'll for sure have many more lenses that will come, and maybe the miracle drops of youth. We talk about the pharmacological treatment, the already published, although small numbers, but of the sympathetic, mimetic, and SADs using the depth of focus enhancement, but also some possibilities of targeting the crystalline lens, trying to make it softer. Yesterday, the nanodrops were kind of a miracle possible in the future. Who knows? And then maybe use the drops in combination with something else like LASIK, monovision, in cytophagic with monofocal IOLs. We have many, many possibilities. Combined refractive procedures are an important part of the refractive practice, can be elective or corrective procedures. We still have concerns on accuracy, precision, and safety. And we have to do studies in order to know the future of ocular monitoring of the therapies in order to get our eye youth. Thank you.